Well, good morning. Happy New Year to you. You know, my question always every New Year is, how far into January do you go till you stop saying Happy New Year to people, right? I think we're still in the realm of we're still okay, right? February? Oh, okay. So, what are you looking forward to this year? That's my question to people, instead of what's your New Year's resolution. I get to go to the Holy Land this fall, and I invite all of you to come with me. We're doing a church trip to the Holy Land in October. So I invite you to come. I'm really excited about it. The more we go into Mark, I'm like, wow, I get to see these places in person, and you can too. I would love to have some fun people with me. So do consider coming along on this trip in the fall. There's more information at the church about that. Why don't we pray, shall we? Let's center our minds on God. Gracious and holy God, Lord, this is the day that you've created, this day that we come here together as your community, and we just set aside the concerns of the world. And we just let you minister to us. We let you just nurture us and speak to us. And so, Lord, we are looking forward with anticipation to what you might have to say to us today. So use these words as your words, Lord, not mine. And may we learn from Jesus, from the first words that he uttered in Mark's gospel, and how that might be personal to each one of us today. In Christ's name we pray, amen. So last week, Brian started us off on this sermon series as we're going through the entire gospel of Mark all the way through Easter. And as he pointed out, as we saw last week, you know, Mark's gospel doesn't start with the nativity stories or Jesus' genealogy, but goes right into his inauguration of his ministry when he's baptized by John the Baptist. And Brian also pointed out that Mark's writing style in this gospel is very brusque. You know, he doesn't take time to linger in these stories. He uses the word immediately and at once about 40 times in his writings. There's a sense of urgency and immediacy to each story. And so I think as preachers, as we're up here, the pastor's preaching about this gospel, it's kind of our job to slow us all down and just kind of be deliberate about looking at what is really going on in this gospel. And so before we go into our text for today, which is really just for a couple of verses, it's also very quick, we need to get a scope of kind of how things have been flowing. Last week, we heard God's words as Jesus was being baptized. And he said, "This is my son, my beloved, with whom I am pleased." And then Mark goes right into the story. He says, at once the Spirit sent Jesus into the wilderness, and he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and angels attended him. So boom, just like that, we've had this spiritual moment in this baptism, and now Jesus is thrust into the wilderness for 40 days. And that's all the detail that Mark gives. So if we could, it would be really easy for us to just skip right by that. But we know in Matthew and Luke's Gospels that there are all kinds of details about what took place during that temptation. And if we go too fast, we might miss the importance of this actual event. So let's think about this a minute. So Jesus was just given his identity in his baptism as being the Son of God. And then when he goes in the wilderness, he's tempted as to how he's going to use his identity. And Matthew and Luke tell us that he was tempted by all of the human desires that we have for fulfillment, for success, for power. And despite these temptations, Jesus chose to be obedient to his Father. So he knew what his identity and his role was, but he also had the choice to abandon it at any time, really. And in fact, you know, we know the end of the story. We know that Jesus obediently goes to his death. And when he's in the Garden of Gethsemane right before it happens, he begs God to remove that task from him. But he remained obedient to the very end. So this is an important fact that we need to know about Jesus as we go forward. You know, he's never portrayed, never is a divine clone. He's not this kind of automaton that just has no choice or desire of his own. You see, when he was baptized and confirmed as the Son of God, he also chose to take on the demeanor of a servant. So he didn't just lord it over us, but he served God, he obeyed God in his life. You might remember Paul's words in Philippians, Jesus being in the very nature of God did not consider equality with God as something to be used for his own advantage, but he made himself nothing, taking the nature of a servant and humbled himself even to the obedience of death on a cross. So right after this temptation in the wilderness, Jesus travels back up to Galilee where he's from, and this is where our text picks up today. After John the Baptist was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. So these are Jesus' first words in Mark's gospel, and it's the beginning of his ministry in Galilee. So his first words, they have these two declarations, and then they have two instructions for us. He has this divine blessing. He says, the time has come. Now, this doesn't mean chronological time. He's talking about what is known as God-appointed time. It's the word is kairos in Greek. Jesus' arrival, it did happen in history, but what he means is in the totality of God's story, it is the time when prophecy has come to a close. That's why it coincides with John the Baptist, the prophet, going into prison. That time is over. And the final phase of history has begun, is what he's saying. This is what God-appointed time means when he says, the time has come. And it's presenting us with brand new and unparalleled possibilities. So, the second blessing that Jesus declares is the kingdom of God has come near. Or actually, a good translation is it's at hand. So this podium is close by to me. He's saying that's how close the kingdom of God is to you. So we need to pause here for a moment. What does this term kingdom of God mean? Do we really know what we're talking about when we talk about the kingdom of God? I mean, it's really kind of a mysterious idea, this concept, right? It's kind of confusing, maybe a little vague. I mean, we do not know what it's like to live in a kingdom. We don't live in a monarchy. We haven't for a few hundred years. We don't know what it's really like to live in a kingdom, right? Although we're very interested in British monarchy. We have a fascination with that. But we don't, as Americans, it's really kind of a foreign idea to us, having a king and living in a kingdom. You know, it's funny because on my first day of New Testament class at seminary, and I had this preeminent Mark scholar, actually, Dr. Black. And Dr. Black got up and he asked all of us, the first question he asked in this class was, what are the Gospels about? And of course, you know, we were brilliant and we said, well, Jesus, right? Wrong, he says. The Gospels are about the kingdom of God. So, we need to have an understanding of the kingdom of God. And I'm going to give you a little biblical background. Once upon a time, long, long ago, there was this established idea in the Old Testament that God is king. He's the creator of the world. He's exalted above all his creatures. He rules in majestic splendor. In God's reign as king, this was initially recognized when Moses led the people out of slavery in Egypt to freedom, and then given this law, this Torah law, and they recognized God is our king. And then if you recall in the Old Testament, the people weren't satisfied with God as king. They wanted human kings. And so there was a series of human kings that really failed miserably at their task. And so, the people of the Old Testament, though, they also believed that God as king would be ultimately manifested when this future Messiah would come. And this Messiah would reign in this age of eternal life and this heavenly reign of God. And this is what the Messiah would be bringing about. So Jesus comes onto the scene, and he upholds all these ideas. He agrees with all this, but he departs from another Old Testament belief. And that belief was that there were righteous in the world and unrighteous, and that the righteous were the ones who put on the yoke of Torah and they kept the law perfectly, and that they would be a part of that heavenly realm, and the ungodly, the unrighteous, would be annihilated by God. And Jesus said, nope, I'm not on board with that. He said, in fact, I'm the fulfillment of the law. And he said, I want you to take my yoke upon you. Follow me. Learn from me. See how scandalous he was? I mean, that was completely audacious. It was blasphemous to them that he was saying this. And interestingly, Jesus never spoke of God as king, and he never talked about God's sovereignty over the world. But instead, he talked about the kingdom of God, and he taught about entering the kingdom of God. So remember that story of Nicodemus in John's gospel? He comes to Jesus and he says, you know, how do I get into this kingdom, you know? And Jesus says, well, you have to be born again. And Nicodemus doesn't get it, right? I mean, he thinks literally he's supposed to be born again. You know, Jesus always talked a little cryptically about this stuff. It was very cryptic to people. You know, remember that time that the rich young man came to Jesus and said, I want to participate in this too. What do I need to do? I keep the law. He had this old mentality. I keep the law. I'm righteous. And Jesus said, no, you got to sell all your stuff. Where is your heart? Is your heart with me or is it with your stuff? And unfortunately, it was with his stuff, right? Because the rich young man, he left. You see, Jesus taught again and again that the kingdom of God, it's not a place, it's not a time, it's not this sort of righteous classification or certain good deeds that you need to do. It's a new state of being. When Jesus said the kingdom of God is at hand, he meant that his very presence in their midst exemplified the kingdom of God. Luke quotes Jesus saying, behold, the kingdom of God is in the midst of you. Look to me, Jesus says. This is where you'll learn about the kingdom of God. This is where you enter it. And so Mark, in the entirety of his gospel, he summarizes all of Jesus' life and his teachings in this single concept, the kingdom of God. It is a new state of being that's exemplified in Jesus Christ himself. All right, so I don't think I can get through a sermon about kingdoms without a reference to Game of Thrones. I'm sorry. The books, of course. I never watched the series. Love the books. Okay. So, don't worry, I won't spoil it. I won't spoil everything. But, so in this series, and of course none of you watch it, so I'll just explain it to you. In this series, the world consists of these seven kingdoms, and, actually, now there's nine kingdoms, but it doesn't matter. So there's these kingdoms, they all have territories, they all have leaders, they all have a king or a queen or a prince, somebody that's in control, like a noble house, it's a family rule. So, you know, in the British monarchy right now, so Queen Elizabeth and Prince Charles, they're all part of the Windsors. That's the family that's in the monarchy. So each kingdom has a house, and they all have their really cool, like, emblems, you know, wolf, lion, blah, blah, blah. And then, though, they have house mottos. They have mottos. Winter is coming. That's a weird one. But family, duty, honor. That's their mottos. And so they use these mottos and they wave their emblem flags when they go into battle. And these mottos are supposed to reflect the general character, the philosophy, and the politics of that kingdom. So here's my analogy. The first words of Jesus in Mark's gospel are really the house motto of the kingdom of God. This is our motto, repent and believe the good news, he says. Because he makes this declaration, the time has come, the kingdom of God is near, and then he says, citizens of the kingdom, this is what you're obliged to do. Repent and believe the good news. That's our house motto. In fact, actually, they're the keys to the kingdom. How do we get into this kingdom? How do we participate in it? Repent and believe the good news. So I've got to pause here again because this is a big word. Repent. We actually don't use that a lot from this pulpit. Have you ever heard any of us say repent? Would you come if we said that every week? But it's used throughout our Judeo-Christian heritage. It's religious speak. I don't know about you, but when I was a child, I went to Catholic school my whole life, but I was always taught that repenting means be sorry for your sins. Be sorry for them. Stop it. I'm sorry. And then maybe some of you came to faith as an adult, and maybe you learned that repenting meant I'm becoming a new creation, I'm shedding the old, I'm no longer a slave to sin. And we've probably heard sermons that teach us about the concept of repenting, that it means to turn around, to stop focusing on worldly distractions and to return our loyalty to God. So it might make you think, okay, I get it, I'm supposed to stop sinning. And yes, that's true, but I would be doing a huge disservice if I stood up here and said, Jesus is saying, stop sinning, because there's so much more to it than that. You see, this Greek word for repent is metanoia, and it's a compound word, and this is what it means. It means to change your mind, to alter your way of understanding things. Repenting doesn't mean just stop sinning. It's not about the actions out here. It involves the totality of one's being. It's changing from the inside out. Sinning, because think about it, sinning starts in here, right? Jesus is not calling his followers, he's not calling anybody who wants to enter the kingdom of God to these specific actions and to rule keeping. Can you name any story where Jesus tells people the rules that they have to follow to get into the kingdom of God? No. Instead, Jesus says it's about a type of character that you have. It's what's going on in here. And yes, of course, you can't just be out there sinning, but it starts here. You're not going to want to do this stuff if you're right in here. And so it requires that we alter our understanding about how God's world really works. And we change our minds about how to interact in God's world. So there's no better illustration of the perfection of God's kingdom than the way it was created in Genesis 1 and 2. You know, the first two chapters of Genesis tell us the story. How God lovingly and beautifully created the world and all that is in it. And he said, this is all good. And then he lovingly fashioned humankind in his image. And he said, this is a creature that's going to be in relationship with me and with each other. He created Eve. And then as a good God, he provided for the well-being of these people, of Adam and Eve. He gave them everything they needed. And then, as a good king, he exercised his authority. And he said to Adam, he's like, look, I want you to obey me with this one thing. Just don't eat of that tree, because you'll die if you do. And these are the hallmarks of the kingdom as the way it was created, the way it's supposed to be. It's good, it's beautiful, it's fruitful, it's relational, it has God at the center, it has us in loving obedience to our king. It's beautiful. But what happened in Genesis 3 when Satan came along to Adam and Eve? He changed their minds. He planted a seed in here. Oh, you don't really need to obey God. Oh, you don't really need to keep God at the center. In fact, you have access to the power where you can be your own king and queen. That's what happened. That's sin at its core. We want to take kingship into our own hands. We want to be our own kings and queens. We move from being God-centered to self-centered. When Jesus says repent, He's saying, turn your minds back to God. He's saying, you've forgotten who the real king is. You've altered your understanding about the way things are supposed to work. You see, God-centeredness builds up the kingdom of God, and self-centeredness tears it down. Self-centeredness pollutes the kingdom of God. It distorts our relationships with God and destroys our relationships with each other. I don't know if any of you have been reading along this book that we've been recommending by Tim Keller called Jesus the King. And this is what Tim Keller says about this passage. He says, we've gone the way of self-centeredness. He says, there's nothing that makes you more miserable or less interesting than self-absorption. How am I feeling? How am I doing? How are people treating me? Am I proving myself? Am I succeeding? Am I failing? Am I being treated justly? Right? Who wants to be around that? And then he goes on and he says, why do we have wars, class struggles, family breakdown, exploding relationships? He says, it's the darkness of self-centeredness. He says, when we decide to be our own kings and queens, everything falls apart, physically, socially, spiritually, psychologically. Friends, when Jesus says repent, he's instructing us to turn back to making him king. Because here's the second part of what he says. He says, and believe the good news. They go hand in hand. If we're going to turn our minds back to God, we need to believe that what Jesus taught in his lessons and his life examples, that they're actually going to work. So let me give you an example. You know, one of the strongest human instincts I can think of is the instinct to get even with someone, to retaliate, to get back at someone, eye for an eye. I mean, if you're a parent, you understand this because you know from really young, you know, I know little Johnny hit you, but you can't hit little Johnny back, right? We teach this from a very young age because it's an instinct to just get back. Sue snubbed me, I'll snub Sue. Jack didn't invite me to his poker game, I'm not going to invite him to mine. Those family members are never grateful for what I give them, I'm going to stop giving to them. But Jesus says, wait, repent, alter your understanding about this. I say, turn the other cheek. I say, return hate with love. I say, pray for your enemies. You know, believing in the good news is hearing Jesus' words and trusting that when you really choose his way, when you're obedient to his teaching, when you truly are doing these things, you then are participating in the kingdom of God. It's altering your understanding. It's putting Christ as king and saying, I'm not. I'm not queen. I'm not king. I love how N.T. Wright says in his book, After You Believe. Now, this book, After You Believe, talks about Christian character and sort of what does life look like when we're participating in the kingdom here and now. And he says this. He says, what Jesus did and said was designed to give a decisive answer to this question. What would it look like if God were running things? What would it look like if God were running things? And he says, Jesus' life, his teachings, his examples, that gives you the answer to that question. So I've really been thinking about this over the past few days. I'm telling you, when you have to preach on these topics, it is very convicting. And I thought, you know, what would happen if we Christians got more and more in the habit of taking a challenge in our life or a conflict or a troubled relationship, if we took these things to God and said, you know what, God, here's the situation in my life. Here it is. And you know what, God, this is how I want to retaliate. This is how I want to act. This is what I'd really like to do to this person. And just laid it all out to God. And he can handle it. He likes that. He likes to hear from you. And then what if we said to God, but God, what would this look like if you were running the show? What would this look like if I submitted to you as my king? And I wasn't trying to be my own king. And then we truly opened up to the answers and we aligned ourselves with the actions that follow. You see, that is repentance. That is turning our minds back to God. That is entering the kingdom of God. Can you imagine what this world would be like if we Christians practiced this more? But we get worried and concerned, don't we? What about me? If I don't retaliate to this person, you know, with this person, then who's gonna teach them the lesson they need to be taught? What if I don't get my desires and my wishes? What if I'm not happy in life? Right? That self-centeredness seeps in. And we wonder what's going to happen to us. Can we really be happy if we follow God's rule in our lives? I can't help but think of Jesus' words in Matthew where he said, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then all these things will be added to you." He's saying, don't worry about that stuff. Let me take care of justice. Let me take care of what needs to be done. Just seek my kingdom. Enter my kingdom. Follow me. Easier said than done, isn't it? But if we really took this seriously and we went to our King with our life dilemmas, our conflicts, our motives, our desires, what would it be like if we asked him, God, my King, help me to see this from your perspective? So before I close, I want to go back to this topic of Jesus's obedience and, of course, the lack of obedience of humankind in the Garden of Eden. Of course, we can't ever forget that Jesus is, in fact, divine. But he also lived a life of servanthood to the Father. He was obedient. And because he was able to overcome that temptation in the wilderness, then he was able to go on and fulfill the task that he had been called to do. It's so sad to think of how Adam and Eve, they totally sold themselves short. God had promised so much to them. He'd given them everything they needed, and they could have probably had, I mean, imagine if they hadn't eaten that tree, that would, from that tree, they would have had eternal life. And yet, they chose, they let that seed be planted in their heads, in their hearts. They decided that they could be their own king and queen, that they didn't need to obey God, and they changed the course of humanity. So now at the end of the gospel story, we're mindful today, especially as we go into communion, how the story ends. And we're reminded that Jesus traded the throne for the cross. His ultimate act of obedience was to go to that cross. And to everyone else around him, it appeared completely foolish and absurd, like a failure. But he went on, and he obeyed God, and he went to the cross, and he died, but he conquered the cross. And he rose in triumphant glory, and he lives on as our king. And so we have the choice to participate in the kingdom of God every time we turn our hearts and our minds to God, every time we place him at the center, every time we obey him and declare him king. So friends, Jesus is inviting all of us to enter into this kingdom of God. Let's not miss out on the beautiful reality that he has created for each one of us. Amen. Let's pray. Gracious and holy God, Lord, we are just grateful of this gift that Jesus has given to us, this gift of being able to be present in the kingdom of God and to enter it into your kingdom. And Lord, we admit this isn't easy. We admit it's really hard to not place ourselves at the center of our lives. So we ask your help. We ask your guidance, your strength, your direction. And we lay at your feet those things that might really be conflicting us today. Maybe it is a relationship with someone or a situation where we really just want to take power and we want to be our own kings and queens. So, Lord, we lift that up to you. We ask your help with this. Lord, what might this look like from your perspective? And Lord, we ask you to help us boldly step into those thoughts, those words, those actions that you call us to in this life. And Lord, as we go into this time of communion, as we take this bread and this juice, may they be tangible signs for us of your grace, your love, your forgiveness, your mercy, but really of your sovereignty over our lives, that we are turning our minds back to you. And so, Christ, so Jesus, we lift this up to you in your name. Amen.